Punches an example. And you poke here, put stuff in when it hits there, so you may come back and then we'll want to get positive. Dr. Linehan.
So Eric, I can't tell you how much I appreciate you coming to NIH to be seen. Without people like you, without patients, we would have made no progress over the years.
I appreciate you let me be part of your study.
Well, and as you know, you're affected with HLRCC, and patients affected with this, it's a hereditary cancer syndrome, who can develop cutaneous lesions that are leiomyomas.
Right.
The women can develop uterine leiomyomas or fibroids,
right.
And patients can get kidney cancer.
Right.
And of course, I know this has been really hard in your family.
Yeah, it has.
You lost your brother and your father to
yes.
kidney cancer.
Mm-hmm.
And what patients, what we find in patients with HLRCC is three manifestations in the kidney.
Right.
These patients can get cysts
right.
that are benign.
Right.
They can get tumors inside cysts, and they can also get solid tumors.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, you had surgery a number of years ago
yes.
for a lesion in the kidney,
yes.
but we couldn't really tell if it was a tumor or if it was benign or malignant. But
right.
it came out, turned out to be benign,
right.
which is good.
Absolutely.
So now, when we look at those films,
mm-hmm.
we see a number of lesions that look to us like completely benign cysts,
right.
and that we're going to follow.
Right.
And so for us, you know, we've been studying this disorder since our first patient in May of 1989.
Okay.
And we've been following families with this, and we have now followed almost 200 families. And what we've learned over the years is the following. This is the most aggressive form of kidney cancer there
mm-hmm.
is.
Right.
However,
mm-hmm.
what we have learned is that if we watch people carefully, if we image them every year,
yes.
we detect. If we do detect a tumor, and it's
right.
a small tumor,
yeah.
we get it out, and they do fine.
Right.
And they do fine. So that's our most important message to patients and families affected
right.
with this. Now we know, as you know, we know the gene that causes this, and that is a Krebs cycle enzyme called fumarate hydratase.
Okay.
And this gene. That causes this. We've been studying this because we've made cell lines from patients and we understand the biochemistry of how this works.
Right.
And so we've developed a number of therapeutic approaches
right.
targeting this pathway that
right.
causes this most aggressive type of kidney cancer. And we are really optimistic about how we're doing with that. We're really optimistic about the progress of that. We have trials going. I hope you never need this, of course.
I hope I don't.
Yeah. But we have trials, trial going now.
Right.
And we're very encouraged about
right.
that. And in the lab, we have developed some new approaches targeting this type of kidney cancer.
Yes.
And so we are very, very hopeful about that, very optimistic. It's taken many years to understand how this works, and we have more to learn. But we're very encouraged about where we are. But with a patient such as yourself, with these lesions,
yeah.
these what look like cysts, we have to watch them very closely.
Right.
And if something looks worrisome, then we would recommend surgery. But the good news here is that most people. With this, don't get kidney tumors. We estimate that 85% of people affected with this never develop a tumor in their kidney. But it's the 15% that do that we want to really be on top of.
Could you help me better understand? You said you have a trial group with a potential solution to this. What exactly is involved in that trial? What are they doing?
Well, we're doing a clinical trial now,
mm-hmm.
so we understand how this gene, fumarate hydratase,
yes.
works, and how that's what's called a Krebs cycle
mm.
enzyme. So it's very central to the cell.
Yeah.
So it turns out that when that gene is mutated, is
yeah.
damaged,
yes.
What happens to the cells is they undergo a metabolic shift.
Okay.
So what happens is they're not using the mitochondria, which is the engine room of the cell
okay.
to make energy
yep.
because they can't really. It doesn't work well because this mitochondrial, this gene in the Krebs cycle is damaged.
Okay.
So the cells, to make energy, shift, do a metabolic shift to using sugar to make energy.
Okay.
It's called aerobic glycolysis.
Okay.
Well, so it turns out that also these tumors make a lot of what's called VEGF, vascular endothelial growth factor. So in other words, they make a factor that make from the tumor that makes them form new blood vessels.
Okay.
And they need a lot of sugar, a lot of glucose, these tumors. Okay.
Yes.
So we developed a therapy based on that to target the vasculature and to target the glucose or sugar transport. And we've seen some very dramatic responses with that. We did a pilot trial with that, and we have seen some very dramatic responses. We have one lady who both her sisters died of metastatic kidney cancer.
Right.
Her father died of that. She came to us with advanced disease. And multiple doctors said, well, there's nothing else, there's no treatment for this. And until this, we had no treatment.
Right.
She had a very dramatic response. She became a complete response at 3 months.
3 months.
After 3 months of therapy. And it is now 7 years later, and we cannot find disease. In other words.
So what you're basically somehow dealing with the sugar in the system, the unusual production of sugar, either cutting that
off. Well, not the production, but the consumption.
The consumption,
cutting that off. Right.
And that is actually what lights up when
on the PET scans. Exactly,
okay,
right.
That's what lights up on the PET scan.
Yes. So on
those cells consume the sugar differently.
Exactly. You're way ahead of the game. Exactly.
Okay.
And that's why on the PET scan, it is so positive, because they need that sugar so much. Exactly. Because they can't use the Krebs cycle, the TCA cycle. What they're using is glucose transport and glycolysis to make energy. Mm-hmm. And so that's an Achilles heel for those cancers. And so we can target that. And in the lab, so we took a patient with this who had surgery here, and we made a cell line, the first cell line, human HLRCC kidney cancer cell line in the world.
Right.
And we've now made three of those, actually. And so we can grow that in the laboratory.
Yes.
And that cancer cell line we can also grow in mice. So in the lab, we study how this pathway works.
Yep.
And then we've targeted it with, we have some new approaches which target these pathways. Which are very effective in the cells in the laboratory and very effective in the cells in the mice.
So
we can cure them.
In a layman's terms, if I think of these pathways as a bridge and you're blowing up that bridge, basically.
Exactly right.
Okay.
Exactly right. So you know, it's been 25 years, it's been a long time, but it took time to find the gene.
Right.
It took time, and people all over the world have worked on this, time to understand the pathway of this. But it's we're really optimistic about this, and really believe science works. I mean, it really does.
Is at some point, if it's futuristic thinking, that each person has a unique DNA, that you at some point in the future be able to target individual DNA such that you prevent something from actually occurring, you know, this HLRCC even to kick into place?
Yeah. Yes.
That's your ultimate goal.
That's our ultimate goal. Our ultimate goal is to develop an approach to prevent this.
Right.
All right, it's preventative. So then if you had, because we develop this blood test, we can do the blood test.
Right.
And, and we recommend patients having the blood test at age 8. Because we've seen tumors in 10-year-olds. So we recommend starting surveillance, starting imaging, MRI imaging at age 8.
MRI, what about an ultrasound?
No, an ultrasound is not sensitive enough.
Okay.
We've had patients whose tumors have grown through ultrasounds.
So you're talking about MRI with contrast?
Yes.
Okay. And that would be on every 6 months or
a
year?
No, every year, every 12 months, every 12 months. But because we've seen 10-year-olds, we've seen this in 10-year-olds.
Wow.
We've seen 77-year-olds develop tumors. So people need to be screened their entire life.
Right.
But our goal then is, so let's say we had a 10-year-old mm-hmm. who inherited the gene, who had this altered gene.
Right.
Then our goal would be to say to them, take this pill for 2 weeks a year.
And you're good to go.
And you're good to go. You know, or a month a year or something like that, and you're good to go. And don't, you know, call us if you need us. You know, don't worry about it. Seriously, it's going to happen.
Right.
It's going to happen. I hope to live to see it. I hope it happens
in
my lifetime.
Right. But, I think there's a couple key points for me and key takeaways.
Yeah.
One being in terms of we easily can identify what it is, that 85%+ of the people have HLRCC that never triggers a switch where it flips over
right.
when they go AWOL, so to speak. And the third one is that you have something now just recently developed that addresses all that, that really can solve that. And the ultimate goal then is to have be in a preventative mode versus a reactive mode like right now.
Totally. Absolutely.
Perfect.
Absolutely. But in the short term, mm-hmm. and that is going to happen, in the short term, we screen people every year.
Right.
We do these x-rays, MRIs, and CT scans.
Yes.
We detect a small tumor. Mm-hmm. We get that out. They're good, and we've had many patients that have that we've done that on who've done just fine. The only problem we get into mm-hmm. is if someone doesn't know they have this,
right.
or they don't get their annual screening,
right.
and then we get into problems.
We don't want things. So when you talk about let's say we have a situation, we have someone who has HLRCC, and you've been tracking them, so they recognize they have an issue of concern. When you go in there, are you talking about a laparoscopy, or are you talking about actually opening them up and doing, let's say, a partial nephrectomy?
It's a very good question. Right now, we do them open.
Okay.
Now, we could easily do these laparoscopically. The problem is we want to handle these with kid gloves.
Okay.
We want to handle these so carefully. People with HLRCC can get multiple tumors. And so we do an ultrasound on the kidney. We examine the kidney very carefully, and we do an ultrasound throughout the entire kidney right in the operating room.
Okay.
And we had a patient we operated on not long ago mm-hmm. Who had one tumor. It was very small, mm-hmm. but we just didn't think we should wait. We went in, and we found four in his kidney, and we took out on four.
Wow.
So the other thing is these tumors are different from other kind of kidney cancers, mm-hmm. like the kidney cancers that are caused by the VHL gene mm-hmm. are very different than the,
right.
even though they're both kidney cancer,
right.
they're different diseases. These, when they do grow, they're very infiltrative. They grow into the kidney. So you have to do a different operation. When you do the operation, you have to go very wide.
That is why you need an MRI and you need to take the image for internal. Get the internal look.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Because if somebody does have a tumor
right.
in their kidney, we go wider, because these tumors infiltrate.
Mm-hmm.
They grow into the normal kidney, mm-hmm. and you can't see it on imaging. And you can't see it really grossly when you're doing the surgery. You have to look at the pathology. So we go wide, and we've had patients who've had surgery maybe elsewhere, and the surgeon didn't
right.
realize that. It's
right.
understandable. It's not a common disease, and left disease behind, and it caused us
right.
caused a lot of trouble.
And when you talk about, based on what you told me, is like in my situation, it's a partial nephrectomy. There's actually going to open somebody up, and there's also using the approach you talked about, the recent trial or a combination of both of those. Have you thought about that as well?
A trial of combination of both of them.
You talked about that trial.
Right.
Well, you're a drug intervention.
Yes.
Okay. And you also talked about in a situation when you have to open somebody up.
Do surgery.
Yeah. Have you thought about doing both of those together?
Oh, that's a very good question.
We
haven't gotten that yet.
Okay.
But that, of course, that's the future. In other words, will these drug combinations be so successful, we won't have to do surgery at all?
Right.
I don't know that yet. But right now, we're targeting patients who have the biggest need, whose cancer has spread.
Right.
Okay, that's our biggest need.
Those are the ones we get the drug specific therapy.
Yeah, well, yes. Now, but we'll want to know if we also see an effect on the tumors in the kidney. So is it possible that we could do this for people who have tumor just in the kidney and not have to do surgery? It's possible.
Right.
So, but we're going to have to be safe on that and make sure we do the right thing.
What's your typical expected recovery time? I think about when I had my partial nephrectomy, obviously it took a while, to say the least, to recover from that type of surgery.
Yeah, well, with HLR, when we do regular robotic surgery with a robot, which you do all the time, the recovery is pretty quick.
Right.
I mean, they're out of the hospital in a few days and, you know, could be back to work in 3 weeks, maybe, depending, maybe four, depending how they did. But when you do open surgery, that's a little different because there you're making an incision and going across, so that takes a little longer. But people generally 5 to 6 weeks, 4 to 6 weeks, they can get back to work and do light lifting and things like that. Yeah.
Okay.
So
you're bringing me a lot of good news. I really appreciate it.
Yeah. And well, we're thrilled about how you're doing. So we'll see you, and we'll see you in 12 months.
That's the best news I can hear. Okay. And, you know, I'm glad to be a part of your group, and I want to compliment you and your team in terms of, I guess there's two things that really impressed me, and that is one, your medical expertise, your passion about your work, and your how you handle the patients. I mean, you really believe in what you're doing, and it comes across, and I appreciate that.
Well, you're very kind to say that, and we really appreciate the kind words. I would also say the following. We are so appreciative of you and people like you. I mean, this is really true. If it weren't for the brave patients, the families that work with us, we would have been able to make no progress, none. And so those are the real heroes here.
I think you are. I'm just one in the game, and if there's anything else I can do to help out, I'll be more than glad to help you out.
I appreciate it. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.